So good to see all of y'all here today. To the person who just sent me a message asked if we were live, I hope that you have joined in and realized we are live. And I am laughing up here because when you sent me that message, I saw what you sent me beforehand, and it still brings a chuckle to my face. So to the soul at home that's reminding me, thank you for a chuckle this morning. So glad to have you all here today. Thank you all for coming out. We got a couple of things going on. It is Christmas time. That means a lot of activity in the community and in the church. Couple of events that we have going on that you can be part of, couple ministry outreaches, couple of in-reaches. Wednesday night, we're going to go caroling. We're going to contact a couple of our seniors and shut-ins in the church. We're going to do a modified caroling this year, meaning we're going to go to their houses if they're okay with it, and we're going to keep a decent amount of distance between us and them. Now, what this means is, I know a lot of you don't go caroling because you claim you can't sing. Well, guess what? When you're standing far away, it doesn't matter what you sound like, does it? So come on out, join us Wednesday night. We will start here at the church at 7 p.m. and go out to a couple of our seniors and our shut-ins and go caroling. Spread the Christmas spirit. And y'all, I'm just going to say this. It may be hard for some of y'all to realize how much of a blessing this will be, but some of our seniors have been homebound for quite some time now. And can you imagine what it is to see a brand new face after being shut in for a while? If you can make it, please plan on joining us. Once again, that's going to be this Wednesday night starting at 7. We have a couple of Christmas parties coming up. Candy, do you want to speak about that?
It's the teasing. Tis the season to be jingly. Christmas parties, we have an open house at our house this coming Saturday. What times did we say? 2 to 5. And then if you want to come to that, great. And if you want to come back, we're having an ugly Christmas sweater contest and party at our house at what o'clock? 6, I think. Yeah, 6. So you can come to that. For that, you bring a snack and you bring socks stuffed with prizes, a pair of socks, not just one. And it's Katrina's birthday. She said you could bring her birthday present too. And Angela's birthday is the next day, so you could bring her one too. They would be very excited. So anyway, pair of socks stuffed with goodies, about $10 is your limit, and then we just trade them out. And it can be good prizes, it could be bad prizes, it could be intermediate prizes. We don't care. Just bring socks stuffed with stuff. And that's for the nighttime party. And for the open house, you just bring you in Christmas cheer and get more from my house. We'll load you up on goodies and music and all the Christmas lights you can possibly stand. So just come on through.
And we guarantee that anyone comes to my house will leave with more dog slobber than you could ever want in your life.
Yeah. We'll block them off. We want dog slobber.
Also, next Sunday night, we're going to be doing something a little bit special. We have made a reservation with Yates Thagard. We're going to be going next Sunday night to their live nativity. If you would like to go with us, we're going to be meeting next Sunday evening at 5:45 at Yates Thagard. Not this Sunday night, but when? Next Sunday night. We're looking forward to this. Yates Thagard's putting on a live nativity, and we feel that as a church family, this will be a wonderful event for our kids, for our teenagers, and for us, just to walk through and experience this as what we are, a church family. So if you would like to join us for that, that's going to be next Sunday night. We're going to meet at Yates Thagard at 5:45. So if you have any questions, you want more information, just get in touch with me or Candy about that. One last thing, there is a sign up in the back of the church or as you first come in for the Vast Christmas Parade. The parade is going to be on the 18th. I desperately need you, if you'd like to help out with this, to please sign up. And please sign up quickly. Pastor Trey is trying to decide which trailer, and Yeah, that's something I have to say in my life. Which trailer I need to pull out of my backyard? So if I get the little one or the big one, please go ahead and sign up so I know what kind of trailer to get and so I can have some help decorating it. Once again, the sign-up sheet is in the back.
What time is the parade? What time do people need to be?
What time is the parade? What? 11. 11. Yes, please be there at 10. And I'm sorry, I forgot. I know who I need to look to when I have to ask questions now. So if you'd like to participate in that, please sign up so we have some idea. And we're going to need some help decorating the trailer this year. So sign-up sheets in the back. Please take a moment and fill that out. These are the announcements that I'm aware of right now. We're going to take a minute. We're going to stand up. We're going to greet one another. Just let everybody know that you're happy that people are here. And during this time, if you would like, you can go ahead and bring up your offering. We have the offering plates up here. Please drop it in the plate. But let's go ahead and stand up, greet one another, and tell each other how happy we are to see one another.
I can return back to their seats. I'd let y'all go the whole time. Pastor Trey would be mad at me. So if you guys want to take out a hymnal, we're going to go ahead and practice for Christmas caroling. We're going to sing number 91, Silent Night, Holy Night. We'll go ahead and do it a cappella so you guys can get your voices primed and ready. So please stand and join me. Y'all ready?
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender. Silent night, holy night, wondrous star, lend my light, with the angels let us sing. Alleluia to
you guys are ready for Wednesday night. Everybody can be seated.
Nerd nugget.
Nerd
in the ocean, guess what color they are?
Purple.
They are purple. How'd you know?
they have all these slits in them? Why hash?
To make them look like a seashell.
Well, it makes them look like a seashell. It does do that. And so when the waves and all the current go around, it goes through the shell instead of blowing it around. So they burrow into the dirt, and they burrow this part down because there's no hole on this end. And then the water, all the waves and the current and the tide goes through here, so it helps them get where they're supposed to be.
I see a show in Disney where there's this bird, and he eats those.
Yeah, they need all kinds of urchins. These don't have a whole lot of natural predators, though, because they're not like potato chips. They don't taste good, and there's nothing in them really that's nutritive. There's only like 5 or 6 predators for these.
I want to see it.
Oh, hold on a minute. I'll tell you more about it. Do you know what else they do to try not to get moved around in the current? What happens? They eat sand.
I knew it.
To make them heavy, so they don't go anywhere. So they burrow into the sand, they eat the sand, and they've got these vents to help them. They call these lumioles, fancy vents, name. And this, how about this? Since this is just a skeleton and it's not a live one, it's called a test. So just like what you do at school when you're doing vocabulary words, it's a test. No, they don't call it a skeleton, they don't call it a shell, it's a test. So they're not in the ocean, they don't relax. But this is one of the very most sought after things when people are shell seeking. How many of you have ever actually found a sand dollar? Were you super stoked or no? Because they're precious, they're hard to find. Usually you find pieces of them. Alright, now I'm going to do something. You ready? I'm going to break it.
No!
Watch. Come up here and look. In here, look, if I break it, look at these tiny little birds.
Birds.
Doves.
Those are birds.
Huh?
Are they birds?
Well, I'm going to take it. I'm a flying.
Hey, those look like moths.
Well, they don't like moths.
Yes, they do.
They do not.
It looks like a shark. Or butterflies. They look like butterflies or moths.
Well, for all our intents and purposes today, we're going to call them birds. Okay? And they're calcium. That's all that's really left here is calcium. Like the calcium that we have. You could, but it'd be crunchy and it would taste good.
Yeah, I want to eat it.
Don't eat it. Remember the last time I tried to bring a sea urchin dead, egg him? He liked him. He's weird. Okay, y'all sit back down. You can hold a piece if you want.
I want to eat it.
Y'all can take it over. Oh, don't eat it. How easy it was for me to break.
Yeah.
So you take them home and you put them on your Christmas tree.
Yeah.
Children's Church with Miss Angela. So let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for beach days. Thank you for seashells. Thank you for the exciting things that we find in things that have been cast off from the ocean, things that are no longer alive that we find worthy. Lord, we thank you that you find us worthy when we're dead in our sin, that you want to pick us up and seek us out and make us worthy again through the blood of Christ. We love you so much, and we thank you for loving us. Amen. And I probably have one for every one of y'all to have one if you want to do that.
Advent prayer, merciful and loving God, who sent your messengers, the prophets, to preach repentance and to prepare the way for our salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. Us, grace, we pray to heed their warnings and to forsake our sinful ways, that we may great with joy the second coming of Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Today is the second Sunday of Advent. We come to the lighting of our second candle of Advent. Historically, Advent comes from Scandinavia. During the shortest days of the year, the people placed lighted candles in a wheel. After the coming of Christ, the custom was adapted by the church to demonstrate that the people dwelling in darkness were given a great light by the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Just as spring promises new life and light, so God promises new life and light and found in his son, Jesus Christ. Isaiah 7:14 tells us, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, a young woman shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." The world waited on the Messiah in darkness. Advent sets the mood of waiting in the darkness for the light of the world. Christ is the light of the world that defeats the darkness. In him is our hope. Today we focus on how God broke into human history to provide us with a Savior. May we offer praise and thanksgiving to God for the love that provides for all of our needs, even for our forgiveness. The gold candle we lit last Sunday to symbolize the purity of God's promise to save us through the root of his house, Jesse. You light the gold candle. The red candle we light today reminds us of the great sacrifice of Jesus Christ in leaving heaven and coming here to provide us with the light of his hope, salvation from the sins of the world. Light the red candle. This prayer, O God, our God of divine revelation, we praise you that you loved us enough to intervene in our lives of sin and illumination. We praise you for the gift of Savior and through his life and death, the assurance of salvation, the promise of eternal life. We thank you for the beauty of Jesus' life on earth, for all the joy, the healing, the peace he shared with others. We are grateful for Jesus, a living example of humility, prayer, victory over temptation, patience in suffering. Guide and direct our lives, O God, that we might reflect the light of your holy love. Those who do not know you yet, draw us closer to you and to one another. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Once again, good morning, everybody. Is it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Oh, yeah. So what time of the year is it? Really?
Christmas.
What time of the year is it?
Christmas.
Christmas time. What goes along with Christmas time? What are some of y'all's traditions around Christmas time?
Eggnog,
decorating. That's not a tradition, that's a punishment. Cookies?
Music?
What else?
Gifts?
Duck hunting? You gotta get the Christmas goose somehow. What about caroling? And we're gonna be doing that Wednesday night, and as I said, it's a wonderful outreach. Anybody out there have a favorite Christmas song that you look forward to hearing about this time of the year? Silent Night?
Mary, did you know?
Oh, Holy Night.
Oh, Holy Night. That's my favorite right there.
Where'd you get that from?
We Three Kings. These are all great answers. These are all great Christmas carols. What makes these songs so special? With the exception of my wife, is anybody sing Silent Night in the middle of July?
Yes.
Some of y'all do? Yeah, okay. You play Christmas music all year round?
Yes.
Shh. Today, I want us to talk about a Christmas carol. Now, y'all have named off some really good ones. Silent Night, We Three Kings, Oh Holy Night. These are all great. These are all wonderful. These are all beautiful Christmas carols. But today, I'm going to talk about a Christmas carol that, while you may know the song, and I guarantee most of you have heard this song, maybe you don't realize that it's actually a Christmas carol. The song we're going to talk about today is How Great Thou Art. Y'all know that song? You know, we were looking at the version that we're going to play a little bit later on, and I mean, a lot of people have done this song. It's a great song, but to me, I'm a little bit old school here. Anybody remember a guy by the name of George Beverly Shaw? Shea, I'm sorry, that's right, Shea. Yeah, sometimes you hear a song by a certain artist and you just have to hear it by that person. That's kind of how I feel. This song, How Great Thou Art, while we don't recognize it as a Christmas carol, it is recognized as a Christmas carol all throughout the world. And today, I'm going to tell you why I think that we should think of it as a Christmas carol as well. This song tells the power of God made manifest in the coming of the Christ child. And as Linus reminded us this morning in Sunday school, isn't that what Christmas is really about? God coming to earth as baby Jesus? But don't take my word for it. And even though Linus is somebody we should all probably look up to because the kid is full of wisdom, and y'all know what Linus I'm speaking of, right? Linus from the Peanuts comics. There's something even greater. I want you, if you would, to take your Bible and turn to the Gospel of Luke. Miss Linda told you in Sunday school we'd be looking at Luke chapter 2 probably a lot this Christmas season. So guess what we're going to do right now? We're going to do just that. We're going to look at Luke chapter 2 and we're going to start in verse 18. This is probably a very familiar passage to most of you dealing with the birth of Christ. Luke chapter 2 beginning in verse 8. Now they were in the same country, shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were greatly afraid. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men." Friends, would you pray with me this morning? Father God, once again, we come into your presence. Lord, we are continuously humbled by your acts of love. All this past week, dear Father, you have blessed us, you have protected us, you have supported us in our times of need. Father, as we come to you this morning, we say thank you for moments we recognize and the moments we haven't yet seen where your hand was active in our lives. We offer you praise, honor, and glory, for you are worthy. And for Lord, we offer this up unto you because we love you. We humbly ask now, dear Father, may your presence continue to dwell with us and in this place. May your word speak unto our hearts, unto our minds, and unto our souls. May your wisdom be made known in our lives, and may we follow you with our words, with our deeds, and with our lives. Come now, dear Lord, continue to bless us. In your Son's most precious name we pray. Amen. On the back of your bulletin, I printed the words to this song. We're going to sing it later, so you may want to keep this handy. But what I'm going to do today is I want to walk through this song and show you why this is such an important reminder of how great Christmas is. The first stanza of this song speaks of the lordship of God. Now, I could stand up here and speak till I'm blue in the face, and I could offer you countless numbers of Bible verses telling us, who made us? God. Who made the world? Who made everything? Who is the Lord of all? Like I said, countless verses to back this up. But let me ask you a question. Why did God create this world? Why did God create everything around us? Why did God create all of this and then give dominion over all of this world unto us? God did this to provide for us. God did this to benefit us. God gave us all of this to help us. But how many of us have become so enraptured by the gift that we have forgotten to look to the giver? You ever see that happen around Christmas time? You give somebody something great and wonderful and they're so wrapped up in the gift, they throw the card away and they have no idea who it's from? All of creation is the Lord's. Now, with that in mind, we need to turn back to the Christmas story. It's very interesting. When God decided to announce to the world that his Son had been born, God did something that our world today would kind of find weird. When a celebrity today wants to get a story out, when a celebrity today wants to get something out there to the public, what do they do? Twitter. Any of y'all out there watch TikTok? Good, because it rots your brains. But today, when somebody wants to get a story out, when somebody wants to release something, they'll put out a Twitter, they'll put it out a TikTok, they'll put it out on social media so that it reaches everyone that it can. When God decided to tell the world that his Son had been born, what did God do? Did he go to the great amphitheater in Rome and proclaim from the stage? Did he do that? Did he stand up on top of the temple in Jerusalem and shout with all of his might what had happened? What did God first do to share with the world that his son had been born? God went basically out to the middle of nowhere to share with the world the greatest news of all. This angel in the middle of nowhere told these shepherds the news that all humanity had been longing to hear. And let me tell you something, friends. When this angel shared, it was something special. So, do we have any proud grandparents out there today? Anybody proud of your grandyoungins? When you first found out that your grandyoungin came into this world, you went and hid somewhere and turned your phone off and didn't talk to anybody, did you? Anybody do that? Or were some of y'all walking through the grocery store with your phone like this on your side, like a six shooter? You run to a friend, oh, hey, I heard, like, oh, picture my grandchild. Any of y'all do that? Were you proud to share with your friends about the birth of your grandchild? And I'm saying grandchild, parents, I'd ask if you did that, but if you had a newborn, you're probably too busy with a newborn to do that, right? Usually when we think of the birth of the baby Jesus, we think of a very simple affair. After all, where was baby Jesus born? In a stable, in a manger. We think of the baby Jesus being greeted by a tired mother and a worn out father, a couple of shepherds, and whatever animals were in the barn that night. Friends, even though we may think this, the reality is what happened that night was probably the greatest and most amazing thing in all of creation. You see, in that day and time, the tradition was when a family had a newborn baby, the parents would pay or have friends go throughout the town singing at the top of their lungs that a new child had been born. Mary and Joseph couldn't do this. We know as we look at the scripture, were Mary and Joseph rich? Did they have a lot of money? Nope. Did Mary and Joseph have a lot of friends in Bethlehem at this time? They didn't even have a friend that was willing to give a pregnant woman about to give birth a room. That's pretty lonely, isn't it? But even though Mary and Joseph couldn't, God could. I want to pay very close attention to these two verses because in these two verses, something amazing happens. Look at verses 13 and 14. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. What happens here in verses 13 and 14 is for the only time I can find in Scripture, heaven itself opens up and reveals itself fully to this world. We get the clearest picture of what heaven is like in this passage. Now, I know so many of you out there are saying, well, Pastor, I look in Revelation when I think about heaven. You know, what do we think about when we think of heaven? Streets of gold. You ever heard that? Yep, that's in the Bible. That's real. Don't count me wrong on that. That is real. We think about streets of gold. We think about not needing a sun or a moon because the glory of God lights everything up. That is all true. That is all scriptural. That is all fact. But this moment when the angels announce the birth of Jesus, it shows us what heaven truly is beyond anything else. We see heaven descending. And what do the creatures and what do the angels and what does all of heaven do? They sing out glory to God. This is what it's all about. Heaven descending to share the good news and to open its gates unto us. The song, How Great Thou Art, the first stanza says, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the roaring thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. We have seen in the Old Testament the glory of the Lord. When Moses would come down the mountain after speaking to the Lord, he would have to wear what on his face? He'd have to wear a veil because people couldn't even look at him. The glory of the Lord was so much upon him. When they opened up the tabernacle in the Old Testament, Scripture tells us that the presence of the Lord filled the place and it was like a great and overpowering smoke. But nowhere in Scripture, nowhere else, is the greatness of God shown to humanity as clearly as it is here in Luke chapter 2. The angel appears with what all around him? The glory of God. And heaven itself descends to share this message with us all. I say that this is the greatest example of God's power in all of Scripture. Pastor, how can you say that? How can you say an angel, an angelic being singing in a field, just a bunch of shepherds, is the greatest source, is the greatest sign, is the greatest example of God's power in all of the Scripture? How can I say that? Because it's true. Verses 10 through 12. The angel said to them, Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all the people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be your sign. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. God has come to earth. He is among us even now. That which generations have been longing for, that which generations have been praying for, that which generations have sought more than anything else, has come to pass. No longer is God distant and removed. No longer is heaven inaccessible. He is now here. And even greater, God came to earth, not as the unmerciful judge that he has every right to be. But how did God come to earth? What was the sign the angel said for the shepherds to look for? A baby wrapped in swaddling clothes. Is there anything more innocent and more helpless than a newborn baby wrapped up in swaddling clothes? Heaven. A heaven against which nothing of this world could ever on its own accord hope to enter into has come down to us. The second stanza of our psalm goes, And when I think that God, his son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. The angels and heaven itself sang out the glory of God. And they said, on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. This is the peace that all of creation seeks. God sending his most precious thing to save us. Friends, we so often get so caught up in everything going around and everything going on that we forget. Christmas is the celebration that we are no longer alone. Christmas is the celebration that we are remembered by God. It is the celebration that no longer does our soul know nothing but death and separation. But now, because of Christmas, we have hope. We have love. We have peace. Because God has come to dwell among us and to save us. Our soul, as this song proclaims so often, should cry out at this: how great our God is. We should be like these angels. Y'all, I'm sorry, but I've got to call you out on this. When we sing a song, we kind of half-heartedly sing it. We got to be honest with ourselves here. When we sing, we read the words and we're saying, and we're probably not even thinking about what we're saying. You think the angels sounded like that when they were singing praises to God back on that hillside 2,000 years ago? They were bursting forth with all that they were. Their entire created purpose and their reason for being was to sing the glory of God. And friend, I got news for you. Our purpose is kind of close to that, ain't it? I want you this Christmas season, I want you to realize how blessed you are. I want you to realize just how much God loves you. I want you, as you sing, I want you to cry out as these angels did. Then sings my soul, my God, how great thou art. Our soul should cry out because Christmas reminds us the power of God is displayed in this passage and during this time. Now, if I was to ask you the power of God, what reminds you of that from Scripture? What Scripture pops out at you when we talk about the power of God? Well, I've asked this in the past. People talk about how he split the sea in two. And that's pretty powerful, isn't it? People talk about walking on the water. Any of y'all out there be able to walk on the water? God did. He turned water into wine. He brought the dead back to life. Pretty powerful, ain't it? But I think all of that pales in comparison to what God did right here in this passage. Because this passage is about God forgiving us, even though we don't deserve it. Think about that. God sent his Son to live and die for us, even though we don't deserve the grace and the love that he represents. All of creation hinges upon this moment. All that has been created has fallen. All has come short of the glory of God. And let me just ask this because I think we need a reminder. Did Christ come into this world only after we all agreed to call him Lord? Is that the way it worked? Was Jesus up in heaven waiting for all of us to get together and say, yes, he's Lord? Then he said, okay, now I can come down. Is that the way it worked? Did Christ come into this world only after we all agreed that we messed up? Did Christ wait until every single human checked off the list and said, yeah, I messed up and I need help? Did he wait until that happened before he came into this world? If he waited for that, he'd still be waiting. Am I right? Romans 5:8. Christ came while we were still sinners. Our soul should cry out because Christ came for you and he came for me. Not when we deserved it, because we could never deserve it. Not when we called him Lord, but before then. God loved us even in the midst of our sins. And what is greater than that? What in all of creation could be more valuable? What could be more special? What could be more an act of love than God coming down from heaven while we were still lost in our own ways? Friends, I'm here to remind you, God left perfection to save us from perdition. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 says, "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." The last stanza of "How Great Thou Art" says, "When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art." Friends, Christmas isn't just about the presents. It's not just about the cards. It's not just about the carols. It's not even just about that event that happened in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. Christmas is about the moment that we all will face, the moment we will all stand before God. Because of Christmas, we have the ability to stand before God and cry out, "How great thou art." But I have to ask you, when's the last time your soul truly cried out to say thank you? When's the last time your soul truly cried out just simply to say, "My God, how great thou art"? You may sing the song. Maybe you're like, some of y'all are like me. So every so often a hymn like this will just pop in my mind and I'll just start singing it in my mind. When was the last time you actually did what this song speaks of? Please, there's so much going on in the world today. Don't let Christmas pass you by. Don't you get so caught up in everything that you forget what it's really about. Take a moment. Ask yourself, is God truly great? Has God showed his love to you? I want you to think about it. How great is God to you? I'm going to ask David to come forward. Here in a minute, we're going to sing this song. And I'm going to invite you that as you sing this, I'm going to invite you to truly think about it. I'm going to move down front. And the altar is going to be open. As we sing this song, if your soul speaks to you and says, "Come down and praise him," do so. If your soul says, "Come down and talk to him," do so. If you need to stand in the pew where you are and simply praise him, by all means, do so. Praise him. Remember him. For what he did, and for what he did solely for you. Our God is great. Our God is awesome. Our God is amazing. And it is my hope and prayer that your soul and mine would cry out to him and simply say, "How great thou art." David?
Please stand and join and sing number 10 in your hymnals, number 10.
consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art.